Buddhism, and then we'll move on to other things, specifically Tibetan Buddhism. So a little bit about the life of the Buddha. The Buddha, now we learned that when he finally decided to teach, he kept teaching for a number of years and died at about, at least the estimate is about 80 years of age, or as people say, he passed into parinirvana. Parinirvana. He left his body and went on to whatever other place, nirvana kind of place he was supposed to go. This is a depiction of the Buddha here in his final resting. He lies on his right side, and he basically says to everybody before he dies, all things are impermanent, carry on, and keep realizing this, carry on, and that's about it, and he passes away. I'll step out here, sorry about this. Figure this out. Okay. This is the actual words he said. He who practices my teaching serves me the most. He who sees the Dharma sees me. Transient are all component things, meaning everything is made up of other stuff. This is all dependent arising, all impermanence. Strive on with diligence. And here's a painting of him with his followers here. Now, I want to point out a little linguistic thing here. You're going to see words like this, Dharma. Right? When we've been talking, we've been saying things like Dharma, right? So most of the time, Buddhist stuff is transliterated, coming from the Sanskrit. Okay, so Sanskrit would be Dharma, but in the Buddhist time, they spoke a language which was a dialect of Sanskrit called Pali, P-A-L-I. And Pali, you'll see a lot of early Buddhist stuff is written in Pali. So rather than saying Dharma, they'll say Dhamma. Now, I used to live in Boston, so for me this is very easy, because all I do is take the Sanskrit and apply a Boston accent, right? So, you know, instead of saying it's a wicked pisser, right, I would say it's a wicked pisser, right? That's a Boston accent, right? So this is, rather than saying Dharma, I would say Dhamma, right? So it's a Boston accent. So that's how that's the mnemonic I use in my head. They mean the same things, and so you're going to see some of this. Again, you shouldn't have to worry about it on the test. It should be clear. I'll either write both of them or I'll use the Sanskrit term so you know what it is. Okay? But just in case, I want to be clear about that so you guys don't get too confused. Okay. Now, I'm going to gloss over the details of this. It's important for a history class, maybe not so important for what we're doing. What happens is that after the Buddha dies, a while after, everybody gets together. And they decide that they got to figure out what the Buddha said. And so they have a first council, and they sit around and they say, well, I remember what the sermon, you know, last Wednesday, and he said this. And I remember this thing he did last year, he said this. And they get together and they collect all the sayings of the Buddha. And this is mostly done in an oral tradition. Stuff is not written down yet. Okay? And they collectively remember all the stuff that the Buddha said. And then they come up with the first Buddhist canon, all the things. By the way, this is a stupa here. This is a memorial, a reliquary of the Buddha where they would have buried probably a part of him, or they think they got a little part of him, and so they make this thing out of him. And there's a whole interesting thing about the stupas. These were starting in India, and they look like this, and they progress. As Buddhism moves across Asia, they progress and change. And if you have time, I'll talk to you about stupas and pagodas. It's really quite interesting, but this is the general structure of these. So if you're in Asia somewhere, India somewhere, and you see something like this, you will know this is a Buddhist stupa. It's not a Hindu temple. Very important. It looks pretty similar, but it's not. Okay. So what did they come up with, the Buddhas? The first thing they came up with, the sutras. These are the Buddhist teachings or sermons. And Ananda, who was the Buddha's right-hand guy, was with the Buddha throughout his life, was the guy who was asked to recall the sermons that the Buddha had preached. And everybody said, Ananda said, well, it's this and that, and everybody thought about it, said, yeah, that sounds right. And so this is what became the sutras. Okay? And this became known as the sutta, again, sutra, like Boston accent, the sutta pitaka, or the sermon collection. And this constitutes what they call the middle collection of the Buddhist writings, Buddhist canon. And here's a picture here. This is Ananda, this is the Buddha. This was, again, largely to begin with, this was mostly an oral tradition. And these have gotten written down, in various languages over the years. Here is a sutra in Korean, probably the Heart Sutra, I think, in Korean. I don't know if anybody, is this Korean? Yeah, I think it's Korean. I'm not sure if that's Korean. It might be Korean or Old Chinese.
It is Korean.
It's Korean? Oh, good. Can you read it?
No.
Okay. All right, yeah, I can't remember. But anyway, this is probably the Heart Sutra, which is very common and very popular in China and Korea. So it gets written down later, by the way, not at the time. The next thing they came up with are the Parajika. These are the rules of defeat. These are the things as a monk that you shouldn't be doing. Okay? These are things that get you in trouble and get you kicked out of being a monk. And you not have nuns yet. Okay? The sexism and racial bias, and a little less of that, gender bias in the country is reflected in the structure of the Buddhist church. Okay? So it's mostly at this point men. And here are the rules of defeat. This is what gets you kicked out of being a Buddhist monk. Should a bhikkhu, and a bhikkhu is the name for monk. Bhikkhu is the name for monk. Bhikkhu engage in any type of sexual activity with a female or male being, even an animal, it entails a parajika offense, and he is no longer a monk. He's kicked out of the club. Should a bhikkhu intentionally steal or take what is not given, even if the thing is only worth a quarter of the lowest unit of currency officially used, it entails a parajika offense and you're kicked out of the temple. Should a bhikkhu intentionally deprive a human being of his life or provide him with a lethal weapon or encourage him to die, it entails a parajika offense and you're no longer a monk. Should a bhikkhu has not attained jhana, this is the high level of meditation, absorption, concentration, magga, path knowledge, and phala, fruition knowledge. In other words, if you haven't become, if you're not really well on the road to mastering meditation techniques and getting enlightened, you should not falsely claim that you've attained any of them. Basically bragging about something, fronting that you know this stuff, when you don't, get you kicked out. And there's a bunch of these. Okay? Most of them don't get you kicked out, but these are some of the main ones. So the monks have to follow, there's a lot of rules they have to follow, some 200 and I can't remember what it was, 200 something they have to follow. And this is true today. If you go and become a monk or nun, you decide you really like this Buddhism stuff, and first you become a lay person and you start meditating. Lay person, you do have to do the five things, right? You have to not steal, not kill, not drink or get intoxicated, not do bad sexual stuff, and not use slanderous, backbiting language that causes trouble, right? That's for the lay person. For the monks, you have to do all these 200 of these things. And so you start out as a lay person, you decide you're really into this stuff, you want to become a monk or a nun. Then you go and you take the vows and you take your monks or nuns' vows and include all these things. There's a lot of them. Some of them are really quite strange. I found out this one when I was talking to my teacher a while back. If you're a monk or a nun, you should not mow your lawn. Because mowing your lawn, there's bugs and stuff that lives in the lawn, you're inadvertently going to kill those bugs. You don't have the intention to kill them, but you're gonna end up killing them. That's bad. For a layperson, not a big deal. You're not intending to kill these bugs, you're not meaning to do it. So for a layperson, don't worry about it. For a monk or a nun, it's something they have to be concerned about. Sort of that level of concern, okay, for ahimsa, for not taking life. These are not as bad. These don't get you kicked out. Vinaya Pitaka. Okay, should a bhikkhu intentionally emit semen, except in a dream, it entails a sangadisa offense. Right? So basically no masturbation. Should a bhikkhu with lustful intention touch any part of the body of a woman, even that of a newborn female baby, it entails one of these not kick you out, but serious offenses. Should a bhikkhu with lustful intention talk to a woman with lewd words about the covered parts of her body, it entails a sanghadisa offense. Should a bhikkhu having a large dwelling constructed with a donor not assemble the bhikkhus to appoint a proper site with the surrounding area, it entails one of these offenses. Okay, so all sorts of these things you can't do. So again, if you are, you know, in a Buddhist temple, especially a southern Buddhist temple, and you're a woman and you see one of these monks walking around, don't just run over and throw your arms around and give him a hug, right? You got to check and see what the deal is with these guys, right? But generally, they don't, you know, there's, and again, some of these things a little reflecting the sort of gender biases of the times. And there's a whole bunch of these things. We're not going to go into them in detail, but you can look these up if you're interested. Second Buddhist council, about 100 years after the passing of the Buddha. And again, they do stuff. I think it's this one where they actually start to write things down, kind of codifying all this stuff. And by the way, this is, I think I spoke to you guys before about this. What's this pillar? Did I talk to you guys about this? These pillars? Sure I did. I showed you the Lumbini Gardens where the Buddha was born. And I showed you the pillar in front. This is the pillar of Ashoka. Ashoka was one of these Indian kings who was very warlike and he went around conquering all these people. And he had a realization that killing all these people, you know, to conquer territory was a bad thing. And he became a Buddhist. He converted to Buddhism. And what he did is he went to all the sacred Buddhist sites and he erected these pillars. So this is one of the pillars of Ashoka. And this is a big funeral mound. This is known as stupa. Again, I can't remember if this is the one where they think the Buddha is buried, or at least there's parts of him. Because the idea, a lot of these people say, "Oh, I got a finger bone, so I'm gonna go and bury this somewhere, and you know, this will put in a stupa, a reliquary. You know, this finger bone's got magical powers, right?" And there actually is a place where they supposedly have a finger bone buried. And actually, I'll show that to you later when we get to the Zen Buddhism. So somebody remind me about the finger bone at the Zen lecture. I'll show you where one of Buddha's finger bones is supposedly buried. But they put this up, Ashoka put these up in these Buddhist holy places, and this is one. I can't remember where this might be. This might be Sarnath. I can't remember which one this is. And finally, you have a third Buddhist council, and I think by around this time, women are we're seeing nuns. Being allowed, nunneries are being allowed. And again, things are being written down. And around this time, we're also starting to see some sort of philosophical differences in the direction that Buddhism is going. And again, we don't have time in this class to get into detail about it. If we did a whole class just on Buddhism, which would actually be pretty easy to do, and still difficult to fit into just one semester, we could talk about that. But Buddhism is in India. Buddhism is taking place in India at this time. Buddhism is really in India from, you know, the time of the Buddha up until about roughly, very roughly, around 1000 in the Common Era. And at that time, what happens in India? You guys know?
Occupation.
Occupation by who? Who comes in?
Europe.
Or, not Europeans. Alexander the Great almost makes it to India, but not quite. Who comes in? Genghis Khan is a little bit later, I believe. But he has some relation to this, actually. It's the Mughals, the Muslims from the north, what is now Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan. They come in and they invade India and come in and start taking over. And as good Muslims will do, they don't like the other religions, and so what they do is they start getting rid of all the Buddhist stuff. So they start tearing down any sort of representations, pictures, statues, any sort of Buddhist stuff they don't like, and so they start destroying this. They also do this with Hindu stuff too, by the way. This is something I was just reading about. The Hindus actually suffer quite a lot. Hindu religion suffers a lot. They destroy a lot of Hindu stuff as well. But the Hindu stuff is really more widely spread and is really sort of marinated into the fabric of society to just, you know, the nth degree. It's been around for thousands and thousands of years. Buddhism hasn't been around that long, so the Buddhists suffer greatly. And what happens is, the upshot of this is by, you know, 1,000 in the Common Era to 1,100 in the Common Era, Buddhism is essentially wiped out of India. It's gone. And what happens is that Buddhism survives by being exported to other places. And it does not survive in India. In fact, if you go to India today, the only Buddhists you'll see, as I pointed out in that picture of the Bodhi tree, the only Buddhists you'll see are Tibetan Buddhists who are refugees from Tibet who now live in India, and they're really the only Buddhists in India, other than Westerners and a few other people coming in. You won't see a lot of native Buddhists in India. And that's also because of Hinduism. Hinduism is, again, so tolerant and so all-encompassing. It's like, well, I don't really need to convert to Buddhism. I can like the Buddha, I can do Buddhist stuff, but I'm still a Hindu, right? So it's also has to do with the pervasiveness of Hinduism, that you don't have Hindus converting to Buddhism, because why bother, right? It's pretty similar. So really the Buddhists you see in India now are coming from elsewhere. Okay? And mostly you see Tibetans, because after the Tibetans were driven out of Tibet, they were allowed to set up refugee residence in India where they still are today. And so they're hanging out, and they go to the Buddhist holy places and hang out, and so that you'll see them. Okay? So what happens is you get a diaspora of Buddhism. Buddhism spreads to throughout Asia. And you also have, in between, before Buddhism is driven out of India, you have splits in Buddhist philosophy, and you have to realize that in India Buddhism gets developed to a really high degree. Okay, like you have universities, major universities, Buddhist universities, that their major thing is to study Buddhist philosophy, okay, and they come up with all sorts of things and all sorts of very deep philosophy. I mean, stuff that is the equivalent of the depth of Western philosophy that we have, in our academies now. And so this goes on for quite a long time. And we start to have doctrinal differences. Okay? Doctrinal differences. Some of these are interpretations of what the Buddha said, and some of them are additions. Some of them are like, hey, there's a new idea. We really should, evolve this way. Okay? And I'm going to talk to you about those, because these doctrinal differences evolve into the different schools of Buddhism that we have today. And I'm going to talk about that next. Any questions on this stuff? I know I'm going to gloss over pretty quick, but it's not really germane to what we're going to be talking about. Any questions on anything? Okay. All right. So what happens is that we get three different types of Buddhism. And these three different types of Buddhism, basically, by the time Buddhism is driven out of India, these three types of Buddhism are already sort of established. They're already established by the time Buddhism is driven out of India. And so let me go over these with you. These are important, and these will be on the test, by the way. Something you need to know? Okay. So, the first type is called Theravadin. Also, you'll see this written as Hinayana, H-I-N-I-Y-A-N-A, Hinayana. We don't use the word Hinayana because it has a little bit of pejorative term. We use Theravadin instead. Hinayana means lesser vehicle. Lesser vehicle. So it's kind of like the crappy version of Buddhism, bargain bin Buddhism, right? It's got a negative connotation, so we don't like that. So instead we use the word Theravadin. And Theravadin means teaching of the elders. Basically it means old school. OG. OG Buddhism, right? Original gangster Buddhism, right? Teaching of the elders. This is what the old guys did. It's how they did it back in the day, right? When things were cool. Nobody's cool now, right? It's like rap music, right? Anybody here like the old rap stuff, the original stuff, the OG stuff? Back in the late 80s and 90s, That's the real rap. The stuff they're doing today is just pop music. So, it's nothing, right? It's the same thing, right? So this is the old school. Okay, old school. This stuff, this type of Buddhism found mostly in Southeast Asia. In Myanmar, Thailand, Cambodia, in Southeast Asia. Probably was also down in Indonesia, but pretty much was wiped out of Indonesia. The language, old school, Pali, right? Boston dialect of Sanskrit, in my mind, right? Okay. And schools of Buddhism, and the name of the schools are mostly Vipassana. So if you see a retreat for Vipassana Buddhist meditation retreat, it is in the Theravadin tradition, okay? And we have very good schools of Vipassana. There's a number in America. And you can go to a number of these retreats. And the retreats usually involve meditating for long periods of time during the day, and usually you will remain silent for the length of the retreat. It could be 2 weeks, not saying anything. I have not been on one of these. I have friends, many friends who've been on these, and they say it's life-transforming and wonderful to go that length of time without speaking. My friend Ken Rose, who's a Thai boxing teacher over in Thousand Oaks, he goes to Thailand every year, and he goes up into the mountains and finds a monastery, and he goes and he meditates with the monks for, you know, a few days to a week, and he tells me that the entire time he goes, it's silent, they don't talk. And so this is around, so you can go and find it. So Vipassana. Teachers are called bhikkhu, which means monk. And the types of meditation, they do insight meditation, loving kindness meditation, all the basic types of Buddhist meditation. More about these as we go on. So this is the Theravadin school. Theravadin school around here, I'm sure there must be some. You've got to have some around. I'm sure probably in LA there's people who do Vipassana stuff. You can probably look around and you can find it. I don't do Theravadin Buddhism, so I'm a little less in touch with what these guys are doing. But I'm sure there's some around. So that's the first school, that's the old school. The next school is the Mahayana. Maha means great, yana means vehicle. This is the school of the great vehicle. The great vehicle. Great vehicle. Ben. Well, you know, Hinayana here is pejorative, right? You say, well, this is the great, this one's not so great, right? No, we don't want to do that. Okay? Great vehicle, Mahayana. This type of Buddhism is prevalent in China, Korea, Japan, Vietnam, Cambodia, some parts, and I would also now add in the West. It's also very, very popular here. And the languages that are represented are Sanskrit, Chinese, Japanese for the most part, also Korean. I should remember Korea. Korean. And now, of course, English. By the way, I didn't include English in any of these languages, but you can now include English in those, and most European languages as well now. Okay, so I'm putting these are the original languages, the early languages these things are in. If you want to do current stuff, you can include almost all at least Western languages. Sanskrit, Chinese, Japanese, Korean. The schools, you may have heard of these, Zen schools. The Chan schools, Nichiren school, many, many other ones. Some of them just call themselves Buddhism, but they do Mahayana Buddhism. You see this in China. They say, yeah, it's Buddhism. What kind of Buddhism do you? I don't know. We do Mahayana Buddhism. So that's, you know, Chinese Buddhism. Okay. So again, lots of schools of these things. You are probably most familiar with the Zen school, which comes out of Japan and has had a huge impact on the way Westerners think about Buddhism. The Chan school is the Chinese version of Zen. The Nichiren school, the Jodo schools, these are Japanese versions. I'll talk about these when we talk about Japanese Buddhism in a couple weeks. Teachers' names are Roshi, which is a Zen name, Guru, all sorts of different names here. And types of meditation. Well, in addition to these basic Buddhist meditations on insight and loving kindness, they also add in a sort of a form of sitting meditation where you do all the mindfulness and the concentration meditation sort of together. This is the hallmark of Zen. And Zazen means just sitting meditation. Okay? Sitting meditation. And they also, some Zen schools use something called koans, which are tricks in language, using language to get people to stop their thinking. And we're going to talk about these. We'll talk about some poems and stuff. Maybe we'll play around with these in class a little bit. We'll talk about these. So this is something that, you know, probably you guys, most of you guys have heard of Zen, right? How many here has not, anybody not ever heard the word Zen? It's really entered in our language, and we have all sorts of things. And generally, we take Zen to mean, oh, just kind of a chill, cool thing, right? Oh, yeah, man, I came home last night, my roommates were freaking out, but, you know, I just went in my room and was just, you know, hung out by myself. It was real Zen, right? But that's not what it means here, okay? Zen means here is a sort of intense, calm but very intense awareness. And so it's not the same as sort of the common usage of Zen. So this is something that, again, hopefully by taking this class, we will dissuade you of some of these common usages. You will have a little deeper usage. So when you go to name your business, you may not call it like the Zen Bar, right? You have a bar. I went by bars in LA or something. It's called the Zen Bar or something. You know, no, that's not. You know, that's not what happens in a bar. Zen is not. I mean, it can happen in a bar, but usually not. Hopefully, this will dissuade you of this word, which is now being so widely distributed and used that it's losing its meaning. So we'll talk. So we're going to have a whole lecture on Zen. I'm not going to go into that. Just so that you know, the Mahayana has. There's other schools besides Zen. What is the main thing that ties the Mahayana schools together? This is really quite interesting to me. The main thing that ties the Mahayana schools together is that Buddhists back, you know, after the Buddha was around, they're in India, they're thinking about Buddhism, they're developing the philosophy. They go, yeah, you know, this idea is that Buddhism, it's become really goal-oriented. You know, the goal is to reach nirvana. We have this goal. We're going to reach nirvana, right? And what some Buddhist philosophers realize is that that leads people to become attached to nirvana, attached to the idea of nirvana, attached to the goal. And really, Buddhism is about giving up attachment, but this sort of subtle attachment to this goal of reaching nirvana is creating a problem. People are not really able to achieve enlightenment because they're still attached to something. They're attached to the idea of achieving enlightenment. That makes sense? And so what some smart guy did is say, well, you know, get rid of that goal. It's a good way to do that. Because what did I tell you guys is the rubber meets the road definition of enlightenment. And how does it manifest in your everyday life? Compassion. Compassion. So you can go and you can talk all the philosophy and all this stuff all you want. But you know how it manifests in human existence, in human life, is through acts of compassion, through a sense of feeling compassion. Okay? And so what the Mahayana Buddhists came up with this idea is that what we're going to do is we're going to forego entering into nirvana until all beings have achieved enlightenment. In other words, it's like the airplane, right? Hopefully none of you have ever been in an airplane that's crashed or had an emergency landing. But what happens when that thing crashes? You have the exit seat. What do you do?
You're responsible.
You make sure, you open the door, you make sure everybody gets out first, and then you leave. Right? This is the same idea. So the Mahayana Buddhist, you take the vow, the bodhisattva vow. Bodhisattvas are these beings who do this. That you reach, you're almost ready to reach enlightenment. You're just about there. But you forego the final step into complete enlightenment so that you can remain in this world and help out others. In other words, you can manifest the compassion. You manifest enlightenment. Okay? You basically practice. You manifest the enlightenment. But you forego becoming completely enlightened until everybody else becomes enlightened. You're basically the exit seat at the plane. Okay? Open the door, helping everybody out. You get out last. Okay? What this does, in my opinion, is this removes the goal orientation of Theravadin Buddhism. Why does it remove the goal orientation? Just think about the task of making sure everybody is enlightened before you're getting enlightened. You've seen some of the people around you? Right? This is going to be a long time. Right? Anybody drive into school today and got behind somebody? Oh my God, you know, like. It's going to take some people a really long time. So you're on the long, when you go Mahayana Buddhism, you're on the long, in one way you're on the long term plan. Okay? On the other way, actually, you're on the short term plan. This is the opposite effect, right? This is the thing. So one thing, intellectually you're doing, you know, goal orientation, you might as well just give up on ever becoming fully enlightened because you know, you got to wait for everybody else. It's going to take forever. And people are really pretty stupid. And, you know, a lot of people have a long way to go, right? So give up on the goal. But by giving up on the goal and by manifesting the bodhisattva vow, by manifesting this rule in Mahayana, what you do is you practice compassion all the time. So by practicing compassion, you actually have a sense, you have a glimpse, you have a taste of enlightenment all the time. So while it gets sort of the final sort of goal, you actually now are marinating and steeping yourself into compassion, which is basically marinating and steeping yourself into the attitude of enlightenment. Okay? And this is what Mahayana people do. Okay? So it's actually a pretty subtle, pretty cool trick that they do to add this in. Now, Theravadan Buddhist, Arab Greek, idea here, go off in the woods, you know, remove yourself from other people, remove yourself from society, refine yourself, become enlightened, and then once you're fully enlightened, then maybe you go help other people, whatever. That's their idea, okay? So this idea of, the idea of Theravadan Buddhism, the personal enlightenment first. Theravadan Buddhism is more like being on the plane and the oxygen goes out and the oxygen masks come down. What do they tell you to do? You have a kid next to you, what do? You put your oxygen mask on first, and you can breathe so you don't pass out, and then you put the kid ones on and then you help other people, right? That's Theravadan Buddhism, right? Mahayana Buddhism is like the exit seat, plane crashes, you gotta get everybody out, you open the door, make sure everybody gets out, and then you go out, okay? One is not better than the other. They're just different. They're just different, okay? Just different. However, Mahayana Buddhism becomes very, very popular and really spreads in these places, becomes very popular. And there's some reasons for this. One is that, again, this attitude of compassion, that you directly see Buddhists, expressing this characteristic of enlightenment through compassion. Okay? And so Buddhists are out there doing good works. They're not removing themselves from society. Theravadan, the idea is to go off in the woods, you know, be a forest monk, you know, gradually remove yourself, you know, so you maintain your life. And the Mahayana people, because they have this bodhisattva vow, actually engage in the world. And there's these very famous Zen Oxfording pictures that describe this. Maybe I'll talk about that when we talk about Zen. But the Mahayana people, because they have this bodhisattva vow, you can't be by the exit of the plane and just say, well, I'm going to take off and go off outside the plane. No, you're actually required to stay in the plane and help people off. So the Mahayana Buddhists are a little bit more, have an emphasis of staying in the world and helping people. And I think this is what makes it very popular. Also, you can have these figures of bodhisattvas, these people who've taken this bodhisattva, these beings that are almost enlightened, but stick around to help us out. And these form very nice figures, personified figures for worshiping, praying to. In other words, a little bit like, if you think about compared to Catholicism, it's a little bit like the Catholic saints, right? These beings are almost enlightened, you know, but they're just here to help us. And so if I pray to them, ask them for forgiveness, or I need something, I can pray to them, I can ask them, I can meditate upon them, and I can, they can either impart their power to me, or they can impart their example to me. And so we'll find a lot of these figures in Mahayana Buddhism, and some main ones. We'll find some main ones. Okay. Some of these are derived from Hinduism. Some of these bodhisattva figures are derived from Hinduism. Some come from the native cultures where they're at. Some are sort of probably derived from Hinduism originally, but then really undergo some relatively radical changes. So we'll see a lot of these here. Okay, so again, this is something that makes it popular. Also, the use of mantras. Meditation is very common in Mahayana Buddhism, and the mantras tend to be, what they'll tend to do is chant the Buddhist sutras, especially the Heart Sutra and the Lotus Sutra, very popular. They'll chant these, sometimes in a very abbreviated form, in a sort of mantra form. Sometimes they'll just actually chant the whole thing. So you'll see this if you go to a Mahayana temple to a service, you'll see them doing the chanting. Kinds of things. Okay, so this is engaging for people. This is very engaging. So this becomes a very, very popular form of Buddhism. And I'll talk more about this when we get to Zen Buddhism. And the last branch here is the Vajrayana Buddhism. Vajra means diamond or indestructible, thunderbolt. That's two kind of meanings. And yana means path. So this is the way of the indestructible thunderbolt path, diamond way, sometimes it's called. And this is a form of Buddhism that is found, predominantly developed first in India, and then went to Tibet, and from Tibet to Mongolia, Nepal, Ladakh, which is where northern India now, where the Tibetan Buddhists have been resettled in India. and through through and into China, parts of history it was into China, but it wasn't what the Chinese claim now, which is that, you know, that Tibet was part of China. It was actually the way around, that China was subjugated by Tibet, and so they had to pay tribute to Tibet, and so the religion spread into China. So if you go to China nowadays, you'll see a little bit of Vajrayana Buddhism around. It was been illegal for a long time, and so you know, they're letting a little bit more of it out, not much, and Tibet is still the iron thumb is on the people of Tibet. I'm going to talk about that in some detail a little bit later on. Okay. The languages, Sanskrit and Tibetan, are the main languages, and I would now add into there also English, very important. A lot of Tibetan stuff now has been translated into English and into European languages. Very, very common now. There's been a lot of big translation projects of Tibetan Buddhist works into English. Tibetan Buddhism is very interesting because Tibetan Buddhism, you can kind of think of this as a timeline. This is the early Buddhism. So early Buddhism is just starting. It gets exported down the south of India, from the south of India to Sri Lanka. That's another place we see Theravadan Buddhism. And from there into you know, what was Burma, Myanmar, and into Thailand, out of these Southeast Asian countries. And sort of early on, right? Mahayana, sort of, you know, in the middle of the time when Buddhism is in India, this gets exported first to China, and then, you know, from China to Japan and Korea and Vietnam and other places. Tibetan Buddhism is a type of Buddhism that gets exported at the fruition of Buddhism in India. So Buddhism develops in India to a very high degree, and at the end of that time, before the Mughal invaders into India, Tibetan Buddhism is exported to Tibet. It's actually brought into Tibet. Tibetans actually consciously say, we like that, we're going to bring that in. Okay? And this, so what they're getting in Tibetan Buddhism, in Vajrayana Buddhism, is the height of the development of Buddhism in India. So it's the last Buddhism that gets developed in India. And so what it does, it's very interesting, because it includes stuff from Theravada and the Mahayana. It includes these systems of Buddhism, but also adds some other stuff on top of that. Okay. So what Tibetan Buddhists will like to tell you is that their system of Buddhism is a complete system of Buddhism. It includes the Theravada and the Mahayana stuff, the teachings and everything, but it also has its own techniques that are drawn from the sort of the height of Buddhism in India. And these are techniques that come out of the idea of tantric Hinduism. Okay, so tantric Buddhism. I'm going to talk about that to you. We'll talk in detail about that. So the idea is that Tibetans like to think that their form of Buddhism includes all the other stuff. Now, that is partly true, because what the Tibetans do is they commission a huge translation project. They commission people to go to India, find all the Buddhist teaching. And remember, at this time, there are these major universities in India, Buddhist universities, places like Taiwan, huge Buddhist universities. And what they do is they commission people to go in, but go down to the Buddhist universities, get everything, and bring it back to Tibet. But wait a minute, we have a problem here. What's the problem? Well, we don't have any written language in Tibet. Well, let's fix that. Let's create a written language. We'll take, you know, India, Sanskrit, that's the height of culture, that's the height of learning. So let's take the Sanskrit alphabet, we'll modify it a little bit, we'll take the Sanskrit alphabet, and we will then use it to express Tibetan language. So we have to do the project of creating a written language. So they do that. Tibetans do that. They create a written language. Then we're going to go down to India, and we're going to take all this Buddhist stuff from Sanskrit, and we're going to translate it into Tibet. And we're going to bring it back up into Tibet. So this is what they do. And they come up with these two collections of work, the Tanjur and the Kangyur. You know, remember those, these collections of Buddhist works, and they bring these back up to Tibet. Now, what happens in India, to make a long story short, the Mughals start invading India, they start destroying all the Buddhist stuff, they destroy the great universities, all this knowledge, all these teachings, all this stuff that's written down is destroyed, it's lost. Okay? They look up in the mountains, up in the Himalayas, well, you know, we could go invade up there too, you know, somebody says, well, you know, it's 14,000 feet average elevation in the Himalayas, the winters are, you know, 50 degrees below zero, you know, the elevation to get there is, you know, we have to, it's going to be this incredible climb to get there. And once we get there, what do they have that we want? They have a bunch of yaks and yak milk, and that's about it. So maybe we'll just forget about, you know, bother invading Tibet. So the Mughals, and the Tibetans are very, can be very warlike. They're at this time, they're very good warriors. So really, we're going to go up there, and we're going to go invade these guys for not much gain in order to get, you know, some yak's milk. Yeah, it's not worth it. So what happens is the Mughals leave Tibet alone, and the Buddhist teachings are destroyed in India, but they survive in Tibet. So all the teachings from all these schools survive in Tibet, where they are still available. Still go up to any Tibetan Buddhist school, and now they're actually translating these into English. So it's been a big translation push to translate the Tanjur and the Kangyur into English, as well as all the other Tibetan Buddhist teachings, the Vajrayana teachings that are actually originated in Tibet. So the Tibetans like to think of their form of Buddhism as sort of the flower of Buddhism that's preserved. Okay. Lots of schools of Tibetan Buddhism. We're going to talk about all these many different schools. There's four major sects. There's within these sects, there's other traditions. And the Tantric traditions are probably throughout. You have traditions that are very much like Zen, sort of sudden realization traditions like Dzogchen and Mahamudra. I can talk a little bit about those. You call the teachers Lama. Lama means basically Great Mother. What is it in the Catholic Church? What do you call the lady who's the head of the nunnery, Mother Superior? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of Lama, kind of means that. Kind of means Mother Superior, Great Mother, even though it's, you know, mostly guys who are Lamas. Rinpoche means precious one, so you may address your teacher as Rinpoche, meaning precious teacher, precious person. Tulku is a designation for a Lama who is a reincarnated Lama. In other words, he is really, really fulfilling his Bodhisattva vow. You know, he dies, but rather than go off in Nirvana, he gets reborn so he can come back and continue to help people and teach them the Buddhist Dharma. And so Tulku is related to this. And so I'll talk about this tradition of reincarnated lamas in Tibet a little bit when we get to Tibetan Buddhism. Okay. Types of meditation. They include all these sort of basic types of Buddhist meditation. They don't do much in the way of koans. They do have some teaching stories. They don't quite have the koans. They have a lot of sitting meditations, lots of different kinds of sitting meditation. They use mantras and chanting like the Mahayana stuff. And they add on to all that stuff, they add on a system of visualization. So not only are you engaging the body through the posture of sitting, you're engaging the mind through sound. You also, in Tibetan Buddhism, add the use of the mind by engaging it through the imagination and visualizing imagination. Okay? And this is pretty unique in forms of other forms of Buddhism. A lot of the techniques that come, visualization techniques and those things, a lot of these things are related to stuff that comes out of Tantric Hinduism. Okay? Tantric Hinduism. And also the idea that you manipulate the energy centers of the body, the chakras, also used quite extensively in Vajrayana. Okay? So it's really got something for everybody. So if there's you don't like doing this in Tibetan Buddhism, you can find something else that will fit the bill. Okay? They do a lot of what they call puja, so they take a lot of structure from Hinduism. Again, and again, the way they, it evolves a little bit differently, but the idea is there's a lot of symbolic representation of these beings, and then you're using the sort of personified deities, but the idea in Buddhism that these aren't deities like in Hinduism, the ultimate idea is these deities in Tibetan Buddhism are essentially emanations of the mind, okay? They're mental emanations, and so you're working with your own mind by working with these images of these deities. They represent different qualities of the mind. And so you can work with them in a sort of personified form, makes them easier to work with. And so they have this as a unique thing in Tibetan Buddhism. Any questions on these? And we'll get more into detail about this stuff. We're going to go first probably talk about Vajrayana Buddhism because we're going from India, we're going to be moving eastward, and then Tibet is the first place we're going to come to. And then we're going to get into Mahayana Buddhism because now we're going to move into China and Japan. So we're going to go in the class sort of geographically west to east, but chronologically we go from India, we go down south, and then we go east, and then we go north essentially from India. So chronologically, or we go time-wise, you know, we go Theravada, the Mahayana, the Vajrayana. Geographically, we go Vajrayana, we go really Theravada, and then we go Vajrayana, and then we go to Mahayana. Okay. Yes.
So Theravada and Mahayana, would they still look at, say, the Dalai Lama as a spiritual leader, or is it very specific?
Yeah, the Dalai Lama is the spiritual leader of the Tibetan Buddhists.
Right.
Okay. He's not the spiritual leader of all Buddhists. This is a big mistake that people make.
Yeah.
However, I will say I saw the Dalai Lama speak in San Jose, California, many, many years ago. And there with him up on the stage, in addition to a bunch of Tibetan Buddhists, were a bunch of Zen Buddhists came in. He actually put them on the stage with all the other Tibetan Buddhists, and he didn't treat them any differently. He put them there, and they were there, and they, you know. So, you know, I think, and again, I I'm not positive about this. I think what you'll find is among other types of Buddhists that they'll have great respect for the Dalai Lama because he's a guy who's seen as embodying really basic Buddhist principles. I mean, really basic stuff out of Theravada and Mahayana. You know, when you hear the guy talk, he's not always going off on some elaborate, you know, Vajrayana thing. He really is very, very direct. And you know, he talks about basically Buddhism is about kindness. And somebody said to him, you know, what, explain your religion. And he said, my religion is kindness. You know, I mean, he's not putting on a bunch of airs and being all, you know, superior. And so I think a lot of other Buddhists respect him for that. You know, they respect him also for the struggle that he's gone through in his life. You know, having to escape the Chinese and have be in charge of the Tibetans in exile and all that stuff. And I'm going to talk to you probably too much about that later on, because it's a cause that's very close to my heart, and I feel for the Tibetans, and I know something about it. And so I'll talk to you about that. Now, if you are Chinese and you come from a place where you are really, you know, pro-Chinese government, you think the Chinese government is great, and then you might be offended by my lecture when I talk about that. I've had some students in this class who were very offended when I put down the Chinese, you know, and I think they took it as I was putting down the Chinese people. But I would encourage us not to judge the Chinese people by the actions of their government, just like I would hope that people don't judge us by the actions of our government, right? You know, that there's a difference. And I would say not all the government, you know, just parts of the government. The Chinese government's a little bit more lockstep, walking, you know, everybody's walking to the same beat than we have in America. In America, it's like herding cats. But nevertheless, I'm not anti Chinese government. I think the Chinese government is, you know, really quite good at many things. But I am very critical of the way they've been treating the Tibetans. Tibetans have gotten a real raw deal. Does that mean that America is better? No. We just committed genocide on our native people, you know, 100, 200 years ago. The only real difference is that, you know, Chinese are sort of doing it now to the Tibetans. And so we get to watch it. That doesn't make what we did any better. And the Chinese will say this. They'll say, you know, you're interfering in our internal affairs. And who are you to be judging what we do with the Tibetans when you've, you know, wiped out the Native Americans? Well, that may be true. But the thing is, wiping out the Native Americans, now I think we can look back and say that was not a great thing. That was not a good thing. And we should say something when we see people doing it now. So you could say we're hypocritical, you know, to complain. And, you know, that's what the Chinese will say. That may be true, but I still think personally that it's good to say something. And I'm going to talk in detail about the atrocities committed against the Tibetans. So again, if I'm not trying to offend anybody if they're Chinese, or actually the one guy who was most offended was not a Chinese guy. He was an American, a white guy. But he really liked the Chinese government. Took this class. He really was into China. You know, great, you know, Mao Zedong, the greatest thing ever happened, right? So he was really into it, and he was offended, but so I'll just apologize in advance. I don't want to offend anybody, but you should know something that's going on. I mean, again, there's lots of genocide in the world right now. I mean, there has been ever since we've had human beings and we started recording history. There's a lot of genocide. Those of you guys take my other classes, take the Nazi Germany class, I'll talk about genocide. There's a lot of genocide going on, and you know, if we can, as humans, as good thinking humans, try, you know, as religious people, Christians or Buddhists or Jews or Hindus or whatever, try to be aware of propensity of humans to kill each other and try to manifest a little ahimsa in the world, I think it's a good thing. And so again, one of the reasons I'm not giving this lecture to, you know, rag on the Chinese, I'm giving this lecture to say we all need to work harder at being nice to each other. Again, as the Dalai Lama said, you know, my religion is kindness. And I think if you took the Pope, or you took, you know, the, you know, got a bunch of high-ranking rabbis together, you got some Muslim guys, some sheiks or whatever together, Muslim clerics, put them in the same room. My guess is, at their heart of hearts, they would say the same. They would say, my religion is kindness. And the other stuff is all details that are maybe very unimportant, that we can be nice to one another. That's the main thing, because we have a big propensity as human beings to be really, really mean to one another. And if you don't believe me, just go flip on your computer and check out the internet and see what's going on in Syria right now. You know, I mean, this is swimming up river, this idea of being kind to one another. We're really swimming up river. And so, again, anything that we can do to promote kindness to one another, at least my personal belief, is a good thing. Okay? All right. Okay, so that's that. Sorry to go off on that too much. I wanted to mention again these five lay precepts. Again, by the way, I'm not trying to convert anybody here to become Buddhist, so don't think that this is what this is. But again, if you do become a Buddhist as a lay person, this is, you'll go through a little ceremony. They'll cut a piece of your hair. Sometimes they'll give you a Buddhist name, and you will basically agree to adhere by these rules. So you boil down all that Eightfold Path, boil it down, and this is the things, you basically the things that you should not do. There are other things you should do that you'll be encouraged to do, but the bare minimum is the things you should not do. And these are the five lay precepts. Not to harm or kill living beings, not to steal, not to cause harm through sexual behavior, not to cause harm through speech, not to cause harm through the use of alcohol or drugs. And by harm, not only to others, but yourself as well. These are the five lay precepts. So again, you know, you really want to boil it down. These are the basic things about being a Buddhist. And I think I talked to you already now about the difference between Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism. You can go into that further. And not to spend a lot of time on Theravadan Buddhism. Yeah, I used Hinayana here. I used the bad word, right? Hinayana, this is the word, same as Theravadan, okay? I'm not going to go into a lot about Theravadan Buddhism because basically we've already talked about it. And you've already talked about it. We've talked about the Four Noble Truths, the Eightfold Path, and sort of what you need to do as an individual to propel yourself along these things. And that's really, you know, the basic parts of it. And again, the meditation techniques that we see in the Eightfold Path at the end. Insight meditation, concentration meditation, these are the two main things that they will do. We talk about Mahayana Buddhism. Remember, I mentioned these Bodhisattva type characters. This is one of the main ones that we see in Mahayana Buddhism. Not in Zen, because Zen doesn't use much of these Bodhisattva figures, but the other forms of Buddhism, which actually, by the way, just on sheer numbers, the other forms of Mahayana Buddhism, not in Zen, are actually way outnumber the number of Zen people. Okay? We tend to focus on Zen Buddhism because this is something that came to America and it's very popular here. And so when we think about Mahayana Buddhism, we think about Zen. But if you go to Asia, you go to China, and you go to Japan, the Zen schools are very small. There's a very small number of people who practice Zen. And most people are practicing sort of this general Mahayana Buddhism. This is especially true in China and Japan. And so they will have these Bodhisattva characters who they will treat, you know, kind of like Catholic saints who they worship. And this one is Kuan Yin, or in Japan, Kwannon. And she is like the Virgin Mary. You know, she is the one you go to, and she's the Great Mother. And she's there to protect you. So she's very, very popular. You'll see Kuan Yin and Kwannon statues, little statuettes, pictures of her everywhere. Okay? And this is Tibet. This is the Potala Palace in Lhasa, I believe. And again, you go here, you'll see these symbols. So here is what, you know this one, right? Y'all know this one now. What is this? This is the Eightfold Path. Okay, and you see these deer? Why are the deer there? The deer there because the Buddha turned the wheel of the Dharma, gave his first sermon in the deer park in India, where he expounded upon the Eightfold Path. A lot of times you'll see these deer there. And you'll see these kind of reliquary things. I think these are like stupid things here. So we'll see a lot of these things. And again, in Tibet, there's a whole system of these monasteries, and monastic life becomes very, very important in part of the country, and it becomes really interwoven into the fabric of the culture. Buddhism becomes interwoven in the fabric of the culture of Tibet, Tibetan Buddhists, and Tibetans. So it's really difficult to be a Tibetan and not be a Tibetan Buddhist. Those things are really almost inseparable. And that's changing, of course, as Tibetans are, you know, are migrating out of India now, and if they can get out of China and get out of China. The Chinese are on a big campaign to secularize all the Tibetans, to get them out of this religion. They think this, you know, religion, you know, according to Mao, you know, religion is the opiate of the masses, and all these Tibetans have been deluded, and so we're going to undilute them by, you know, giving them a, you know, a more materialistic education, this kind of thing. And, but we're going to talk about these palaces and the palace life in Tibet a little bit. Okay, now, of course, my favorite thing, we'll talk about maps. You guys know how much I like maps. So again, India, here's India, Indian subcontinent. Buddhism starts up here in this area. And again, Theravadan Buddhism begins, spreads down Sri Lanka down in this area, and then also down through what's now Myanmar, into Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam, Laos, down into Malaysia, down into the Southeast Asia too, where it doesn't really survive. Down in Indonesia and these places. Okay? This is mostly where the Theravadan Buddhists go. They go this way. Theravadan kind of goes this way. Okay? Mahayana Buddhism, we're not quite sure of the path. Probably there's more than one path. There probably is a path that goes down through here and then goes to China. There's a path that probably goes up into here on the Silk Road and then gets taken into China. We're going to talk about some of the early translators of Mahayana Buddhism who went up this way in China, because what thing you need if the religion is to spread, what's the most important thing it needs? Right? Say I have a new religion. I have a religion about green aliens, and I want to get you on, and not Scientology, different aliens, right? And I want to spread it to you guys. But I come from, let's say I live in, let's pick a place. I live in, I come from Uzbekistan. Kazakhstan, that's pretty close actually where my real relatives come from. I live in Kazakhstan, and I speak whatever they speak in Kazakhstan, some kind of form of Turkish something, I don't know what they speak there. They go a little bit over here, they speak Turkish over here, right? Turkmenistan, I speak Turkish. So I have to tell you about my green alien religion. So if I come here and start talking to you, and by the way, I don't speak Turkish, well, I'm just going to make it up. So I start talking to you like, blah, 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 this is the greatest religion. I'm saying to myself, this is the greatest religion. Check this out, it's really cool. Yeah. But you would just hear blah, 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 right? You're not going to follow my religion. Mostly not. Most of you won't. Some people will. Because they're just, people will do anything. But again, shameless plug, take my 473 class next semester, where I'll go into a lot of detail about that. But let's say most people will say, you know, I don't know, it's blathering at me in some weird language. I have no idea what it is. So what do I need to do is I need to translate from my weird Turkmenistan Turkish language to English. Okay, and so I have to go in, so I got to go to your place, I got to learn your language. Okay, good, I learned your language, now I'm going to take my language and I'm going to transliterate and I'm going to write something down. And then you read and go, oh, that's pretty cool, right? That's necessary for these religions to spread. It's necessary for Buddhism to spread, especially outside of India. Because while people in India all speak Sanskrit, and you know, there's a lot of Sanskrit speakers here, once you get into China, that ain't the case. And Chinese and Sanskrit are about as different languages as you could possibly imagine. And so what you find is the earlier translators of Mahayana go up here along the Silk Road. Remember, the Silk Road goes from China into here all the way to the Middle East. They go up here to the Silk Road, they fall along the Silk Road, they go into China. And for whatever reason, a couple of these guys, I'm going to talk about them in detail, their life circumstances allow them to have learned both Chinese and Sanskrit. And so they actually become translators, and this is how stuff starts to spread. So you have to translate things. Okay? And again, you go from China to Japan, you have to translate. Okay, things get translated. Same thing. And we still see this today. Buddhism is being translated into English, being translated into Spanish. A lot of Spanish stuff and Buddhist stuff in Spanish now. It's been translated into French and German. A lot of these European languages, you'll find Buddhist works. Okay? So translation is a big part of Buddhism. A big part of Buddhism is translation. And one thing you do as a Buddhist to develop good karma is that you help sponsor translation projects. So there's this great book in Tibetan Buddhism. It's this great, you know, teaching. This guy made this incredible insight. You know, it's going to help all these people get enlightened. But it's only in Tibetan. So, you know, you chip in $25, you and 1,000 other people, and then there's a translation project, and they translate the works, and you know, and it gets out. That's a big deal. And then the last migration is India. You have, this is Tibet here, right in this area above Nepal, big area here actually. And the Tibetans sending people down into India, getting stuff, bringing it back up here. And then Tibetan Buddhism then spreads throughout China. And then later on, of course, the Tibetans are kicked out of China into India. And from India, we have a Tibetan diaspora, where the Tibetans then spread throughout the world. And as the Tibetans spread throughout the world, their teachings spread throughout the world. And the Tibetans actually did a very good job of actually seeding Tibetan Buddhist teachings, especially in the West. The Tibetans really recognized very early that Tibetan Buddhism was going to survive in the West. And so they've done a very good job of seeding the Western countries. And they figured these are countries that can support Tibetan Buddhism. Now, commonalities among all schools of Buddhism. And this should be obvious, but we'll make sure that we hit upon this. The Four Noble Truths and Eightfold Path. These are absolutely a necessity if you're really going to have a school of Buddhism. Okay. I would add to this also that this idea of dependent arising. All things are based on something happening before. These are the key elements of Buddhism. And dependent arising is important because you don't get the Four Noble Truths and the Eightfold Path without the insights of dependent arising. So those are the main things, the commonalities. The other thing that's common in all forms of Buddhism are the practice of meditation, even though there are some schools where the practices of meditation are really minimized. It's not as nearly as much sitting meditation. The Jodo school in Japan would be a good example of this. Not a whole lot of meditation going on. But for the most part, most schools of Buddhism, the practice of meditation is very important. And the two main types of meditation that you'll find in some form in most Buddhist schools are shamatha and vipassana, okay? Which is meditation on concentration and meditation on insight. And in some schools, these are somewhat merged together. And I would say the Zen school represents, the shamatha and vipassana Zen school. We call Zen meditation is a merging of these types. Okay? But you'll see these very, very, very common. And the other one would also probably be loving-kindness meditation, which is called metta, a loving-kindness meditation, also very common throughout many, many schools of Buddhism. Okay. And then you have all sorts of different things, and a lot of different things that are brought in from the culture. Okay, but these are the pith of Buddhism.
Okay.
Yes?
You called it in the rising.
What's that? Say it again. Dependent arising. Yeah, that's what I mean. Remember I talked to you guys about that everything is caused by something else?
Does that mean Buddhists are necessarily determinists?
So that's a very good question. Ultimately, Buddhists are determinists. If you think about the Buddha's life story, the Buddha sort of realizes dependent arising in this night before he gets enlightened. And he realizes he sees the causal chain of all his past lives. And he realizes, I got to the point now because all these things happened in the past. And then he sees all the causal chain of all other beings in their past life. That, to me, is a tacit philosophical stance of determinism. However, he's seeing that from the point of view of an enlightened person. So if you're fully enlightened, you know that maybe then things become very, you can see sort of how things are going to go for people. You can kind of become a determinist. We are not enlightened. So we live in a world where there's a lot of things that happen by chance. And also some of those things, those deterministic things, the causal relationship is very muted. You know, like maybe a butterfly gets stepped on somewhere in the mountains of Nepal, and that ends up, becoming a Tibetan Buddhist in America 50 years later. You know, there's a causal chain, but it's very thin. So in that sense, things to us appear as if they're not determinists. And part of the Buddhist, I would say, again, this is extrapolating, this is my own opinion, but part of the Buddhist thing, idea, the project of Buddhism is to become as deterministic as possible about your life. And this is one of the reasons why we meditate. So you could say, everything happens for a reason, or maybe stuff just happens, right? But for Buddhists, it's you spend a lot of time trying to find the reasons things are happening. Some of that stuff you may never get to. You know, it may be something in the past life, it may be so far removed, but you really work on the things that you can work on. And so in that sense, it's sort of a I would say it's kind of a partial determinism. Okay? It's a partial determinism. Yeah, that's my view. Now, I bet you could find somebody who would disagree with that.
That's confusing with the idea of, like, intentionality.
Yeah. Well, intentionality is actually not too confusing, because intentionality is that you are going to, and I assume you mean intentionality not in the phenomenological sense of the word, but in the sense that you have an intention for something.
Or at least somewhat free will.
Yeah, the idea is that you do have free will into the future, because you can make a choice about your karma into the future. And so what you do today is going to determine what you're going to become in the future. Who you are now was determined by stuff that happened in the past. So in the sense of going forward, you do have a degree in Buddhism of free will. And again, this is one of the reasons why you follow the Eightfold Path, because your intentionality will be, you'll make better choices in the future. You have a choice, though. You do have a choice. To some degree, you've been determined by stuff in the past, but again, when you reflect and you become aware, then you develop a degree of ability to sort of captain your own ship, if you will, right? And so you do have, there is an implied some dimension of free will. So it's not like, it's not a mechanistic determinism. It's not like the blind watchmaker started the clock going and things tick, 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 and these gears turn, and you know, on and on and on and on. There is an element that you can bring your awareness into your life, and then you can change the course of that. So there is a space for free will in Buddhism in that sense. And there's also a space where you've done all these things in the past, and you know, now you're going to suffer the karma from those, and so you have to sort of deal with that. And how you deal with that also is a form of free will. So there is a little bit of space for there. It's not a mechanistic determinism. I guess that's the way to think about it. You do have, there's a space for you to, your consciousness to contribute to straightening all this thing up. But if you make a lot of karma, you can't do that. So karma obscures that. So if you're somebody who's just blindly going around making karma all the time, then their determinism is going to be more mechanistic. Yeah, but in Buddhism, it's your responsibility to bring in that awareness. It takes work. This is why some people don't like Buddhism. Because a lot of other religions, you just get people to do the work for you, or you just pray to the God, let the gods do it. You have to do it in Buddhism. Nobody can do it for you. And that, people don't like that. It means you've got to do the work. Right? So this is, again, another reason why Americans like Buddhism so much. Because we love this, you know, we love this. Yeah, you know, it's hard, your own hard work, you know. You know, you live and die by your own, hoist yourself by your own petard, you know. You live and die in your own efforts, right? Not let anybody do it for you. We're Americans. We get out there and we work hard, you know. We make our own destiny, right? Well, that's why we like Buddhism. It fits really well with that thought, right? And so it's there. So, and this, again, that's why I think Buddhism is very, it's easier for Westerners to adopt it. Because it has that sort of Judeo-Christian American value kind of thing, sort of, kind of, in there. And we can, or at least we can interpret it that way. Okay. Then you go to places and you'll see Buddhists who are doing stuff and you go, oh, they're just completely not on the same wavelength. You know, like I was in Nepal, I hung out with a bunch of Buddhists, you know, and like, they weren't thinking about Buddhism the way Americans think about Buddhism. They were just doing it. They're just living it. It's part of their life. It's part of their culture. And they weren't thinking about, oh, I'm doing this, I'm going to get enlightened or whatever. They were just, this is just what we do. It's completely different. So I would say deterministic to a certain degree. There's an implied determinism. It's not completely mechanistic. There's some space for free will.
Another. Do you think when the Buddha attained enlightenment, he realized that it was a mechanistic determinism?
Yeah, because he is a good example of that. I mean, he had to make some effort.
So when the Buddha becomes enlightened, he's no longer... I mean, if a Buddhist were to become enlightened, they wouldn't need to try and follow the Eightfold Path. That would just be happening automatically.
It would be natural.
Right.
That's the way to think about it. Especially if you're a Zen person. It's just natural. You're just behaving naturally. And you naturally, if you are aware, you naturally wouldn't want to go around and kill other people, because then they're going to kill you and all the other things. Your karma would become natural. You're not deluded. You don't have this delusion of trying to perceive everything as being permanent, which causes us to do all these bad behaviors. You realize everything is impermanent. Because of that, your behavior will just naturally flow from that. And so you'll need to have a path. It's not necessary anymore, right? So that's what I've been told. That seemed to make sense to me. All right, why don't we take a little break, take 10 minutes, and we'll go on from this.